In February 2018, we conducted workshops for the municipality of Tiwi towards updating their comprehensive land use plans. The workshop was attended by barangay leaders, IP community leaders, and other major interest groups in the municipality. We are now in step 2 of the 12-step process of the comprehensive land use plan as prescribed by the 2014 guidebook of the Housing Land Use and Regulatory Board, now that issued. And these are 12 steps of the CLUP based on my experience in updating the Tiwi CLUP. Step 2 is about identifying stakeholders. So why is this step important? Participation increases sustainability. More often than not, plans are left in the shelves of local government units and not really that implemented because of, among other factors, social rejection. Participation increases sustainability because projects are more likely to be accepted since the local government unit has consulted or has pre-approved, has obtained the buy-in of the different stakeholders directly or indirectly affected by these plans and programs. What is step 2 all about? The 2014 guidebook shows 3 immediate expected outputs from this step. This step aims to recognize and engage participants who can play an active role in the planning process. Note, active role in the planning process. That is why the most important outputs of this step for me is this: an action plan with the strategies on how to approach and involve stakeholders. Different levels of stakeholders and different economic and social backgrounds require different approaches and different methodologies. As well, it is important to have an information and educational plan for these stakeholders so that the LGU does not waste time in involving stakeholders who are not that active in the planning process. In my opinion, step 2 is one of the most challenging because the number of people or the number of stakeholder groups you involve also complicates and also deepens the participation in the CLUP process. So what activities, one of the outputs of this particular step, step 2, is the stakeholder action plan. In the HLURB guidebook, this 3-column table is prescribed, is given as an example, as a template, show where the stakeholder is identified, the step in which he or they are involved, and how to best engage them, whether through workshops, through interviews, through focus group discussions, etc., etc. My own suggestion based on my experience is for the stakeholders that are involved at the start to be involved until the end, until the public hearing of the comprehensive land use plan. As much as possible, involve these stakeholders in all the steps of the CLUP to make the process more participative. I also want to highlight what Professor Ernesto Cerrote described in his book as the types of stakeholders. In brief, there are 2 types of stakeholders, according to Professor Cerrote. Use value stakeholders who are guided by the principle that land use should return optimum returns to their operator or to the society, while there are exchange value stakeholders who want to obtain as much economic or money as possible in every land use interaction. Think of examples of each type: your mayor, business people, community, you. Which type of stakeholder do you classify them? The type of stakeholder is important because the guiding principles of the stakeholder is the ultimate determinant of the land use decision. How long will step 2 take? We are still using the prescribed sample schedule of the HLURB guidebook, which outlines the activities for the CLUP formulation until step 9 for 18 months. Step 2, the guidebook describes step 2 to be able to be accomplished in 2 months in conjunction with step 1. In my opinion, it is important to use existing TWGs, existing council compositions as the stakeholders, as a basis for the stakeholder list. So what did it look like in my Tiwi experience? Again, I was an environmental sector planner for the Comprehensive Land Use Plan of Tiwi in 2018, where I was a member of a team of faculty members, a faculty of UP that performed or conducted an extension project for the municipality of Tiwi. So we interacted with LGU stakeholders in 2 consultation workshops. One being for the validation of data and information we gathered, and secondly is to present the priority programs and activities that we have formulated for their LDIP and consequently their CLUP. So we interacted with LGU stakeholders in 2 consultation workshops, both within the span of 4 months because of time constraints. Second highlight of my TIWA experience is that major stakeholders were invited in more engaging meetings for deeper conversations. As an example, we met with the Tiwi Geothermal Corporation and also the Tiwi Watershed Managers because of their large stake in the land area of Tiwi. The municipality of Tiwi is a geothermal reservation through Philippine law, and the geothermal corporation manages almost half of the municipal land area. So it is frankly, our process in Tiwi was constrained by our own other commitments and also timelines for the submitting the comprehensive land use plan. So this is one of the workshops our land use planner, Professor Juanico, presenting the Tiwi the CLUP process and the data gathers, the data that we have gathered. So how can LGU planners maximize step 2? Again, step 2 is identifying stakeholders, and for me, it is a complex but important step for the comprehensive land use planning process. As an LGU planner, as an outsider and consultant, I would encourage LGU planners to incentivize increased participation of stakeholders in the whole CLUP process. There is a saying by Filipinos during election that wala namang magbabago, nothing will change. But it is important that through the information and education campaign, the local government will show that participation of the stakeholders can help develop the comprehensive land use plan to a plan that will benefit not only the local government leaders but also the present and future generations of the LGU. It is important to remember Sherry Arnstein's ladder of citizen participation, that consultation in its current form is a form of tokenism and can be increased through citizen control or even at least delegation of powers. This is already inculcated in our local development planning process through the participation of civil society organizations in the development council, but there's always room for improvement. Increasing participation, however, will honestly increase the time and cost of the consultation or the planning process as a whole. Second, LGU planners can maximize step 2 through enhancing their negotiation and mediation skills. For future steps or for following steps, these stakeholders will definitely exercise their powers and interests in the local planning process. It's important as an LGU planner to be able to not dictate but mediate. Sure, we can propose plans and programs, but the different stakeholders who are involved have their own interests and have their own meaning of benefits and costs, which the LGU planner and the local government as a whole should understand and integrate. What do you think of this episode? Send me a message at enptino.com. Also, follow me on Facebook, LinkedIn, YouTube, and Spotify.